Hello and welcome to the Power BI September 2021 update. In this video, we'll explore what's new this month and see some demos of the highlights. We have some exciting new features for you in the reporting section. First, we've updated the buttons in Power BI to include many new formatting options, including new shapes, custom icons, and more. Before, buttons were only available in the rectangle shape. Now, with this release, we have a much longer list of shapes for you to choose from, including arrows, chevrons, pills, and polygons. You can now also add custom images or icons for your buttons, adjust the image fit, control the icon placement, set alignment and spacing, and add special effects to your buttons. You can find all of these new formatting options in the Format button pane. For a full list of all of the new capabilities, check out our September release blog post. Next, we've heard and responded to your feedback. Now you can turn off total columns in your waterfall charts. You'll find this new toggle in the Y-axis card in the formatting pane. Turn it on, and the totals of your waterfall charts will be removed. Note that this will not affect subtotal columns in your breakdown. And please continue sending us your feedback and ideas. Next, we've also included a new option to create and format series labels in your line charts. Using the series labels option in the formatting pane, you can turn on and format labels that appear on the left or right sides of your series categories in line charts. These supplement the legend in providing clarity on which lines are associated with which categories. Rien will show us a demo of this feature.
Let's say I've got a line chart showing sales over time, like the chart I have in front of me, except instead, let's also say we've divided the data into a bunch of different categories, like so. Then the legend tells us which colors correspond to which categories. But the more lines you have, the less useful it is to rely only on the legend in picking out which line is which. But now you can use series labels in the formatting pane in your line chart instead. These will put a text label next to the lines on your chart, adding to the readability of your visual. So you can put them on, if you so choose, the left or the right of your visual. You can format them in any ways you wish, you know, normal text color, text size, font family, whether or not you want to turn on the background plates, if you have, you know, a bunch of other colors going on in the background and you want to make sure that you have good contrast on all of your text. You can turn on word wrap, and you can change using maximum width how much space you allocate for that text column on your series labels, how much horizontal space you want to allocate in your visual. You can adjust all of this per series as well. And you can format them in a lot of different ways. Line chart series labels as a feature should help address a certain type of visual clarity issue that we've been hearing. And we've got some other improvements to their functionality planned as well, including little guidelines to help make some more space. If you have a lot of lines close together and we don't really have that much room, we can start making more space vertically, and then we can just draw lines to those lines, which will allow you to better associate which text label goes with which line, and other format, you know, other improvements like that. But with what we have now, let us know what you think. Let us know how you think they could be improved. And of course, you know, we always take feedback on how other visuals or other visual formatting could be improved in general, and we'll see what we can do. So try it out. Let us know. Thanks for watching the demo.
Next, you can now apply MIP sensitivity labels to Power BI template files, allowing you to properly classify your files. When exporting to a Power BI template, MIP label and protection set on the Power BI file will also be applied on the new template file. And when opening template files for new reports, that same MIP label set will be automatically applied on the new report as well. In the Analytics section, we're excited to announce the new Insights preview feature. The Insights feature helps users easily find and explore insights such as anomalies, trends, and KPI analysis in their data as they interact with and consume reports. It proactively notifies a user if there are interesting insights in reports and provides explanations for the insights. This feature works out of the box on any report, so consumers of the report can automatically gain insights without any setup or configuration by the report creators. Insights is supported for reports in premium and premium per user workspaces. You can also use this capability in non-premium workspaces if you have a premium per user license. We have exciting new updates for you in the modeling section. First, we've made it easier to write filters for the calculate and calculate table functions. You can now use aggregation functions in the filters when they are used in Boolean expressions. Please note that the newly supported syntaxes improve the readability of the DAX expressions, but don't impact the performance when compared to their more verbose equivalent expressions. We've also added a new parameter to the XIRR function for some situations where it is unable to find a solution and returns an error. This new parameter enables you to specify an alternate result to return instead of an error whenever the XIRR function cannot find a solution. Next, we've made it easier to use the format function to format a value to text based on a user's locale by including it as a new parameter. For example, a date time in the English Great Britain locale will return a string when the day precedes the month and the time is written in a 24-hour format, while a date time in the English United States locale will return a string where the month precedes the day and the time is written in a 12-hour format. Yagun will show us a demo of these improvements.
The XIRR function is a financial function that can be used to calculate the internal rate of return. In some situations, however, it's unable to find a solution and it will return an error. Starting with this release, we've added a fifth and optional parameter that enables you to specify an alternate result, which then will be returned instead of an error whenever the XIRR function cannot find a solution. Let's look at a demo. On the left here, I have a table that contains cash flow information, and beneath it is a measure that leverages XIRR just in general, and it will turn a correct internal rate of return. On the right, however, I have slightly changed the input values. XIRR expects at least one negative value in the payments. So as you can see, I changed from minus 10,000 to positive 10,000, so I expect an error. And that's exactly what happens. If you call XIRR right now, you'll get an error. And if you click on this, it will tell you that it wasn't able to find a result. Now, that error is okay, but if you want to return something else, like an alternate value whenever that happens, you can now do so. So with this release, we added a fifth parameter where I specify just the same input. I also specify the default value for the guess, which is .1. And then I specified minus .99. So basically, if there's an error, return minus 99%. And exactly that's what's happening here in this one, here in the visual. You can see that calculation now returns minus 99% instead of an error, which is way more friendly to your users. The format function allows you to convert a value to a text according to a specific format. With this release, we've added the ability to specify a locale, for example, EN-US, which is useful when working in international settings. Let's look at a demo. As you can see here, I have four measures, each of which use format in a slightly different manner. First, on the left, I've got format the way you've been working with it so far. Basically, I specify the column reference, or in this case, I specify the datetime value that I want to format. You could specify anything, of course. I'm just using datetime as an example. Notice that I'm using DT as a way to express my datetime values. This is a functionality we introduced last month. So I'm specifying a date and a time, and then I'm telling it how to format. And as a result, I get a specific format that omits the time and I just get the date. Now, what happens if I add the locale? There's a new parameter, the third parameter, that allows me to specify that locale. So here I specify the exact same thing, but I added en-gb for the UK. But because there's still a format string, you can see the result in the second column is exactly the same as in the first, because the format string is still present and that's being used. Now, what happens if we omit the format string? So what if I don't specify a format string, blank, for the second parameter, but specify en-us as my locale? And now suddenly that same value is now shown in its full glory with date and time in a format that makes sense for the US. Now the last column, the fourth column, if I switch the locale to en-gb for the UK, I can also specify, for example, things like general date, or just leave it blank for the format string. You'll see that that exact same string is now being formatted for what makes sense in the UK, right? The PM is gone, and also the date, the day and month have switched places. So this is really useful when you're working in international settings, because it allows you to, you know, relatively easily switch the format string based on the user's locale, and you can make dynamic formatting this way.
In the data connectivity and preparation section, we have several new and updated connectors for you this month. First, we are happy to announce that the Power BI connector in Power Automate is now generally available. This connector allows Power BI users to use Power Automate to perform actions within Power BI, including refresh a dataset, perform exports on Power BI reports, or perform an action when a data-driven alert is fired. Over the coming months, we will add additional actions to the connector, so stay tuned. We've also made the Assemble Views connector generally available and made updates to the Azure Databricks, Bloomberg Enterprise Data and Analytics, Data Virtuality, Exasol, and Vena connectors. To learn more about these updates, check out this month's release blog post. Next, we have some exciting announcements for you in the server section. First, we've added automated status roles to the Power BI Goals preview feature. One of the most important attributes of a goal defined within Power BI scorecards is its status. With this new release, scorecard authors will be able to automate status updates based on rules that govern the goal or subgoal. Users will be able to precisely set when goals are on track or falling behind. Scorecard authors will be able to set up rules that automate statuses based on the value, percentage of target met, date conditions, or a combination of the three. Once those rules are set, authors can assign their priority by simply dragging them into place. Next, we've incorporated improved filtering into Power BI goals. Now you can easily view the goals labeled with a particular status by clicking on their associated summary cards, making it easier than ever to see at a glance what's at risk and what's on track. We have also included keyword search, making it easy to search for specific goals and see how they're doing at a glance, without losing context of their parent-child relationships. Check out our monthly release blog for links to documentation and places to provide feedback. We have also implemented a new set of APIs that allow you to programmatically retrieve user and permission information for most Power BI assets. These can help Power BI administrators support access review audits, understand oversharing risks, and see who has access to Power BI assets. For this public preview, we are releasing two types of APIs. The first requires you to supply an asset identifier and will output the users and groups that have been granted access to the asset. The second is an extension to the Scanner Admin API that adds users or security groups with their access levels for one or more workspaces. When you need to spot check access rights for a particular asset, such as a report, a dashboard, or dataset, to assess the potential data leakage risk, you would want to leverage the Who Has Access to an Asset API. And when you need to perform an access review across the entire tenant or multiple workspaces, the Scanner API with the user permission extension will come in handy. To learn more about these APIs, check out the blog post linked in the video description below. Next, to better support the security constraints of some organizations, we've added Service Principal support for the Scanner Admin APIs. Service Principal is an authentication method that can be used to let an Azure AD application access Power BI APIs. This removes the need to maintain a service account with an admin role. To allow your app to use the admin APIs, you need only provide your approval once as part of the tenant settings configuration. We made this a public preview feature last December and are happy to announce general availability now. And with this release, we've added support for the new admin APIs to determine who has access to what Power BI artifacts. Next, we've added some exciting new features in the mobile section. First, goals are now available in Power BI mobile apps. Now, even while you're on the go, you can monitor your goals and scorecards, even check on their progress, all directly from your phone. A new goals hub has been added to the Power BI mobile app, making it possible for you to view your scorecards and closely monitor your assigned goals. With the mobile app's new goals hub, you can stay on top of your targets from anywhere at any time. And to keep your goals up to date, you can update values using either the quick check-in or new check-in options. We've also added a section for the recommended content, helping to improve your Power BI mobile experience and productivity by exploring content from your organization selected especially for you. You can find it in a new section on the homepage and on the new Explore page. Last but not least, you can now request access to reports from the mobile app. Now, if someone sends you a link to a report that you don't yet have permissions to read, you can request access directly from the app. In the developers section, we're announcing that Power BI Visual Offers is being moved to commercial marketplace within the Partner Center. If you have one or more Power BI Visual Offers, either published or as a draft, please take note of this move. For more details and action items, please check out the announcement in this month's released blog post. Next, in the visualization section, we have some exciting new and updated visuals available for you on AppSource. New this month are the SPC G Chart by Cloud2 Limited UK, the SPCU Prime Chart by Cloud2 Limited UK, the Laconic Card Pro Visual by Laconic Charts, and the Timeline Box Visual by TheraTrack. And updated this month are the PAF Now Process Mining Flowchart Visual by Process Analytics Factory GmbH, the Drill Down Network Pro Visual by Zoom Charts, the Annotated Bar Chart by Quirion, the Graphimate Pictograms Visual by Graphimate. And this month's editor's picks are the Sunburst Visual by MAQ Software, the Collaborative Visual by ValQ, the Process.Science Process Mining Visual by Process.Science GmbH, the Lipstick Bar Chart by Nova Silver BV, and the True Chart for Power BI Visual by High Coordination GmbH. You can find these editor's picks and all of the other mentioned visuals on AppSource. Lastly, we're excited to announce a new version of Power BI Report Builder. With this update of Report Builder, the 64-bit version is now available from the Microsoft Download Center and the Microsoft Store, featuring enhanced memory limits and other performance gains. We also provide enhanced support for date time parameters and a number of accessibility fixes related to keyboard shortcuts and screen reading tools. Please note that the previously installed third-party data providers may need to be updated to their 64-bit versions. And last but not least, we invite you to join us at community.powerbi.com for the latest in upcoming Power BI events and opportunities for you to engage with our awesome Power BI community members. And that's all for this month. As always, we hope you enjoy the updates and please keep sending us feedback on what you'd like to see in upcoming releases. Thanks for watching and we'll see you again in the community and see you again here next month.